Hey, welcome to the Connection Video Podcast. You're about to see a message from Connection Conference 2017, our final night session Saturday night with Matt Austin. You're gonna love it. Get ready.
Your prayer is being answered. You are gonna get more. You're gonna get more tonight. Do you believe it? You ready for more tonight? You ready for more tonight? This is what I want you to do. I want you to go ahead and head on back to your seat, but as you are doing it, I'm going to tell you about this friend of mine. He's a new friend of mine, but he is a friend of mine. You know, sometimes you just know. You just know from the moment you get there. And, man, I just got this unique opportunity this past summer to go attend a conference way up in Rhode Island. And I'm just hanging out. And you guys remember Jabin? How many of you guys love Jabin Chavez? It's so weird that he's not here this year because he's here every year with us. But he's kind of here, and here's why. Because I ran into him, and we were catching up, and he said, "Hey, have you ever met my friend Matt Austin?" I said, "No." He said, "Come here, let me introduce you." And he said, "This guy's awesome. You just need to get to know him." And then Jabin just like peaced out. He like went somewhere else. And so here's me and my new friend getting to know each other. And I got to hear his heart a little bit. He pastors an amazing church out in Houston, Texas. And he's traveling all over right now. He's not just an up-and-comer. He's already up and come. Like, he is just killing it. He's preaching all over the place, and you'll see why here in a moment. But here's what I love about Matt. Matt loves the Holy Spirit. He loves Jesus with all his heart. He loves to see people encouraged in their faith. And tonight, I really believe you are going to be encouraged. Are you ready to be encouraged tonight? Lift your hands real quick. You ready to be encouraged? And now would you put those hands together and welcome Matt Austin to the stage. Come on, it's going to get good tonight.
Some praise tonight. Oh, you can do better than that. Give the Lord some praise tonight. You may be seated. Naaman needed a miracle. The prophet told Naaman, "Naaman, go down to the river." We've been talking about the river the last couple days. Naaman went down. The prophet said, "Naaman, dip yourself in the river seven times." And Naaman was a little hesitant at first, like maybe some of us have been. But the Bible said he went and he began to dip himself into the river. He dipped once, nothing changed. Dipped again, nothing changed. Six different times he dipped down into the river and nothing changed. But that seventh time, everything changed. And there's someone in here right now. Maybe you dipped last night. Maybe you dipped this morning or this afternoon. Maybe you dipped in worship just a few moments ago. And what you've been praying for, what you've been believing for, you're not sure if it's changed or not. But I want to tell you, live every moment like it's the moment. Because you never know the moment of God's choosing. And for someone in here tonight, everything is about to change. If you believe that, come on, clap your hands and thank God for it. Pastor, it's an honor to be here. It's a privilege to be here. The hand of God is on your life, on your family's life. If you love your pastors, come on, put it together for your pastors. And every seed that you've sown, every sacrifice that you've made, because this doesn't just happen. Every seed that you've sown is going to come back in a mighty harvest, and your family is going to be blessed for generations to come. I want to speak that into your life because it's going to happen. I give honor to the senior pastors of this house. It's easy to see a platform and not see the pain that built it. It's easy to see a stage and not see the sacrifices that laid the foundation. And so I honor the senior pastors of this house, who without them, none of us would be here tonight. So I think it's due that we just put our hands together and make some noise for the senior pastors of this house, for every sacrifice that they've made to make this happen for the kingdom of heaven. Amen. Amen. Well, I want to get right into the word tonight. So if you've got your Bible, go with me to the book of Acts, chapter number 27. Y'all are going to like me because I don't preach long. I don't preach Pharaoh messages. Pharaoh wouldn't let God's people go. I'm going to let you go soon tonight. Church jokes. Acts 27. Go to verse number 14. I'm going to read from the NIV version if you're following along. If you don't have that version, it'll be on the screens. Acts 27, verse number 14. And before very long, a wind of hurricane force called the Northeaster swept down from the island. And the ship was caught by the storm and could not head into the wind, so we gave way to it and were driven along. Paul finds himself in a situation where he gets caught up in a storm, and the Bible said that they couldn't go into the storm, so they let go of the sails, they let go of trying to plow through the wind, and the Bible said that they literally let the wind carry them. If you would, turn with me to the book of Matthew, chapter 14. Matthew 14, verse number 22. A familiar passage. We've all heard one of my favorite texts in all of the scriptures, but hopefully we can shed some new light on this text as well. Matthew 14, verse number 22, and immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. And after he dismissed them, he went up on a mountainside by himself to pray. And later that night, he was there alone, and the boat was already a considerable distance from land. And I want you to look at this next part right here. Buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. So we read about one situation where Paul is carried by the wind. The wind is at his back. We read about another situation where the disciples find themselves in a situation where the wind is against them. And I want to talk to you tonight just for a few moments from this thought: whichever way the wind blows. Whichever way the wind blows. Worship team, folks on the keys, if you're still here, something's playing. It sounds amazing. It's the Holy Ghost, y'all. The year was 2008. The month was February, and the date was the 23rd, when a much younger Pastor Matt Austin decided that the best way to spend my 18th birthday was to go to a place in Houston called Skydive Spaceland and jump out of a perfectly good airplane. Now, let me tell you something. Peer pressure will make you do some dumb stuff. Come on, can I get a witness in the house tonight? They said if your friends told you to jump off of a bridge, would you do it? And you know, I'm the guy that took that one step better. I said, if they tell me to jump out of a plane, I'll do it. That's how smart I was at 18 years old. So I went to Skydive Spaceland. I was going to experience this for myself. And went out there, and you know, you go through hours of training. If you've ever skydived, if you've ever done it before, you go through literally 8 hours of courses, and 10% of the time is spent teaching you how to skydive. And the other 90% of the time is just telling you all the many magical ways you can die by doing this. It's like by the time you get out of that thing, you are scared to death. And I remember after those courses, it was the most scared I had ever been in my life. But I'd come too far, you understand. My pride was on the line, and people were expecting me to go through with this. So, you know, they come over with that little waiver. You know the waiver that says, if we kill you today, you can't sue us. Come on, you know the waiver. And I said, yeah, that sounds great. You know, I'll put my life in your hands today. And so I signed the waiver and got on the plane, and we headed off. And here's another thing. You know you're in trouble when you get on a plane that doesn't have sides. I'm sitting here thinking, you know, at some point they're going to close these doors, right? Like, because I'm sitting here and I'm like looking out over, and we're about to take off, and I'm thinking, yeah, hey, where's the door, guys? Somebody, we forgot something over here. But the plane didn't even have sides. They never closed the doors, and we took off. And as scared as I was before, I'm even more scared at this point. And I had the luxury of going last, which means that I got to witness all of my friends step off over that abyss and jump out, not knowing if they just got raptured out of here, not knowing if they just bounced off the ground. I don't know what happened to them. All I know is that they're all gone, and I'm next. And, you know, the first time you skydive, they make you go with an instructor. So the guy comes over there, and he edges me up to the edge of the plane, and I look out, and it's terrifying, because when you get up 10,000 feet, everything just looks like a giant checkerboard. Like, you don't see cars, you don't see buildings, you see a checkerboard grid-looking land thing. And so I'm looking out over this, and there was no way I was going to jump, so the guy behind me jumps for me. Now, I didn't hear this said on the videos, Don't open your mouth when you jump out of the plane. I didn't hear it because let me tell you, if I'd have heard it, I most certainly would not have opened my mouth. But whenever I jumped out, there was a four-letter word that came to my mind that I thought best described my feeling at the moment. Now, I wasn't particularly saved, so this four-letter word was a cuss word. And you know, it's funny. That thing slips out of my mouth when I jump out, and this is what happened. When I got my mouth open, the force of the wind was blowing against my face so hard that I couldn't close my mouth. So here I am like this. And literally, the wind was so strong that I couldn't exhale. I couldn't breathe. For about 10 seconds, it scared me to death. And finally, I got my big mouth closed. We got on the ground, and I survived the whole deal. I've never done it again. So if you're thinking about it, it's terrifying. But I learned a lesson. And I learned on that day just how powerful the wind can be when it's blowing against you. Nowadays, they've got these indoor places where you can go and you literally get in like a tunnel, and the wind blows, but instead of it, you know, falling that causes the air to blow against you, they literally will produce a wind that lifts you up. And what you'll see in life is that wind will do two things. It will either blow against you or it will carry you. If you fly very much, you've experienced this. When a plane flies against the wind, it takes 5 hours to travel 800 miles. But when you're traveling with the wind, it will only take 4 hours or less to go the same distance, roughly about 20% time differential, which is a lot, especially if you get on a plane next to a crying baby or somebody that smells real bad. Or listen, I got one better for you. I was on a plane recently, and I got on there, and the passenger sitting next to me was a Labrador Retriever. If you bring it, no, not all. If you bring a dog on the plane with me, I'm going to be like, the Lord, depart from me, you worker of iniquity, because dogs don't belong on the plane. All that is iniquity. But so if you travel very much, you've experienced just how powerful the wind can be. And in life, it's the same way. In life, you go through seasons where it seems like the wind is blowing against you. And you go through other times when it seems like the wind is at your back. You know those seasons where you're catching all the breaks. You get that promotion you've been praying for. And better than that, the jerk that you don't like in the office gets fired. Come on, somebody. It's a double portion blessing. You get in that relationship, and it's the person of your dreams. I mean, they love the Lord. They're beautiful. They're everything you wanted and more. And it's just, it's one of those seasons. Seems like nothing can go wrong. But it amazes me just how fast things can change. It amazes me in life just how quickly the wind can change directions. And where the wind was carrying you, now it's blowing against you. And you don't get the promotion. In fact, the jerk in the office got the promotion, and now they're your boss. You know those seasons. You get in that relationship with that person you thought was the man of your dreams, but then he don't have a job. He don't go to church. He plays Xbox all day and listens to Fetty Wap. I don't do the mumble rapping stuff. I don't do it. We have a friend, a pastor friend. His son's about 11 years old, and it was funny. They put on Facebook recently, just caught my son listening to Eminem. And I texted him. I said, well, at least it wasn't Fetty Wap. At least he's got good taste. Come on, somebody. I'm old. I'm showing my age. Ladies, he was the man of your dreams. But it turns out he's just a clown. Fellas, man, she was an angel at first. But then you found out she was Satan's mistress. And she done slashed your tires. She threw your clothes all over the yard. Started a fight with your mama. Then put it all on Facebook for the whole world to read about it. Ooh, I felt my help coming on that one. Somebody has been there before. And those are funny examples. But I think we all know what it feels like whenever the wind changes directions in our life. You've been praying for something, you've been believing for something, and you don't get the answer you were hoping for. You've been praying for a situation to change, but it doesn't change. In fact, it gets worse. You ever been in one of those kind of seasons when all you could ever want is the touch of Jesus, but it seems like as hard as you try, you've been giving, you've been serving, you've been pressing in, seems like you can't touch him and you need him. It seems like you're all alone. One of those seasons where you can't feel him with you. In life, you go through times, go through storms where the wind is blowing against you. And you go through times when the wind carries you. When we read about two different examples, Paul experienced wind that would carry him. The disciples experienced wind that was against them. I will remind you that in the book of Acts, when the Holy Spirit came, the Bible described it as a rushing, mighty wind. When God moves, the Bible describes it as a wind. And so in life, you go through these times where you feel God right at your side. You feel that wind of his Holy Spirit, but you go through those other times where you're in a storm and everything's against you. And so I'm here tonight to pose this question. What do we do when the wind begins to blow? What is our response to the wind? As believers, as Christians, as followers of Jesus, when the wind begins to blow, how do we respond? I brought something with me when I came from Houston, and you ought to have seen the guards at TSA when I tried to get this thing through. They, like, detained me for an hour. I didn't know if I was going to make it. But I got this wind chime with me, and I did a little research on wind chimes, and I found out that wind chimes are percussion instruments, as you can hear, that are created from suspended tubes, rods, or bells. They can be made of a lot of different objects, metal or wood or even Coke cans I've seen. And I found out people will hang them outside of their residence, outside of their business, because of the visual and acoustic appeal. But not only that, I read that farmers, gardeners, will hang these things up in their garden because it'll scare the birds away, which was interesting. I didn't realize that either. But wind chimes are an instrument that will create simple melodies and songs whenever the wind begins to blow. And it was the Chinese in about 1100 BC that were among the first to appreciate the song of a wind chime. And they masterfully created wind chimes that would sing beautiful melodies whenever the wind began to blow. We read about the disciples. We read about Paul. We established that each and every one of us in here is experiencing one of two sensations. Either the wind is blowing with you or against you. And we ask the question, how do we respond to the wind? I feel like we just need to take a few moments tonight and ask the wind chime. You know what I love about the wind chime? I love that the wind can blow from the north and the wind chime sings. The wind can blow from the south and the wind chime sings. It doesn't matter to the wind chime which way the wind is blowing. When the wind starts blowing, the wind chime starts singing, because the wind chime was made, it was constructed, it was created to produce a song. And the scripture tells us that we were created to produce the sound of praise. And I've come into this place to tell somebody that whichever way the wind is blowing in your life, whichever way the storms are coming in your life, if it's a storm brewing or the Spirit moving, we were created to produce the sound of praise. I'm looking for a wind chime tonight that will get up on your feet and just do what you were created to do. Come on, open up your mouth. Give God some praise. He gave you those hands to clap. He gave you that voice to shout. He gave you that tongue to speak his praises. He gave you those feet to jump. Somebody get up on those feet. Come on, wind chime. Respond to the wind. Whichever way it's blowing. Because there's power in your praise. It's not a church thing, not a Pentecostal thing, not a denominational thing. It's a God thing. There's power in your praise. Just over a month, we're going to celebrate Palm Sunday, the day that marks Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem on his way to the cross. You know what I love about that? He had a triumphal entry before the battle was ever even fought. And the Bible said when he was coming in, the people were waving palm leaves. The people were singing songs of victory. And this was a Roman tradition. It wasn't a Jewish tradition. It was a Roman tradition. When their soldiers would come back from the battlefield victorious, they would welcome them with palm leaves and singing songs of victory. And I want to tell somebody in here tonight, you may be getting ready to go into the biggest fight of your life. You may be in the middle of the worst battle of your life, but God sent me here to tell you that if you'll go into it singing, you'll come out of it singing. If you go into it praising, you'll come out of it praising. You may be facing a cross, but if you'll sing tonight like the wind chime, if you'll shout tonight like the wind chime, God said, I can come alongside you and give you victory in the middle of that thing. Oh, come on, somebody, you're getting too comfortable. Get up on your feet and make some noise in this place. Come on, wind chime. Praise will make demons run. Praise will make doubt dissipate. Praise will make fear run for its life. There's power in your praise. Oh, yes, there is. Don't you worry about what your neighbor's thinking either. They didn't save you. They didn't heal you. They never answered a prayer, and they never can. So you might as well shout to the one that can. That's what David did, Pastor. Pastor Steve referenced it. David got to thinking about God, everything that he'd done for him. Bible said he started dancing. Bible said he shed his kingly garments, because when you start praising God, titles come down. When you start praising God, pride comes down. You can't praise God and be prideful. David started praising God, started dancing, shed his kingly garments. And his wife, Michal, looked at him and said, David, what are you doing? What are you? This is no way for a king to act. And David looked back at her and said, baby, I'm not dancing for you. You know what I want to say to somebody that's critical of your praise, that's critical of my praise, that's critical of the way we shout, critical of the way we jump, critical of the way we dance? You know what I say to them? Baby, I'm not dancing for you. Oh, come on. David said, I'm dancing for the one that brought me through the lion. I'm dancing for the one that brought me through the bear. I'm dancing for the one that found Matt Austin in a jail cell, gave me a purpose, gave me a destiny. Oh, come on. If you're so glad that he picked you up and turned you around, give him some praise in here. I don't care what anybody else thinks about it. We can't have a generation, this millennial generation, of quiet Christians. The world's not quiet about the problem. I refuse to be quiet about the answer. I refuse. God's been too good for me. God's been too good to me. He's brought me through too much. And if you'll look through your life tonight, you may find it hard to shout, may find it hard to do some of the things that I'm saying. But if you look through your life tonight, you'll find a reason to give God praise. Well, I just hadn't gotten my healing yet. God just hadn't answered that prayer. I hadn't got the answer yet. Hadn't got this. Hadn't got that. Well, you got grace. You got mercy. You got heaven. You got Jesus. I got news for you. You can get to heaven with cancer in your body. You can get to heaven with crippled limbs. You can get to heaven with a broke bank account. But you can't get to heaven without Jesus. So if he don't ever do another thing for you, he's already done the best thing for you. And I just think somebody needs to get up on your feet and give him praise like you got the best thing. They can keep everything the world has to offer. Give me Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on. Somebody shout hallelujah. Hallelujah is the highest praise. I like to say it when I run out of stuff to describe him with.
After you say, God, you're good. God, you're awesome. God, you're mighty. God, you're faithful. God, you're powerful. God, you're merciful. But sometimes when you run out of stuff to say, you just got to say, hallelujah. Come on, give him your highest praise. Because he alone is worthy. He alone is worthy. We could get on a plane tonight. We could go to Saudi Arabia. I could take you to the Green Dome where the so-called Prophet Muhammad lays buried. And millions go to visit him. Because when Muhammad died, he stayed that way. We could go to Sri Lanka on that same plane. And I could take you to the Temple of the Tooth where the remains of Buddha are. It's just a tooth. But you can see it. Because when Buddha died, he stayed that way. But if we got in the same plane, Pastor, and we went to Israel, I could show you the very tomb where the Romans put Jesus. But you wouldn't find nobody because he may have died, but he didn't stay that. Oh, come on. He's alive tonight. He's in this room tonight. He's moving down your aisle tonight. And he's worthy of the highest praise. One more time. Give him the highest praise. He alone, he's not one of many. He's the one and only. He's not a Lord among lords. He's the Lord of lords. He's not a king among kings. He's the King of kings. And he said, if my name be lifted up, I'll draw men unto me. Woo. I want to be where he is tonight. I want to be in his presence tonight. I want to touch the hem of his garment tonight. I want to see my life change tonight. Come on, wind chime. You can get your miracle tonight. Everything in your life can change tonight. I thought about Bartimaeus, Pastor. Bartimaeus did something radical. Bartimaeus had ran out of options and he was desperate, because desperate people do this kind of stuff. People who are hungry for more, people who want to go deeper do this kind of stuff. Bartimaeus was sitting there, and you can sit down, but don't get comfortable. Bible calls him Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus. But when we find him in this story, he's Bartimaeus the beggar, blind Bartimaeus the beggar. Which tells me at one point he was born from a family of note, Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus. But he lost that title, lost his affluency, lost his family somehow. They disowned him somehow. Bible calls him blind Bartimaeus. Doesn't say he was born blind, because it says that about the man born blind. Which tells me maybe he wasn't always blind, Pastor. But at some point, he lost his vision. And so here's this man that knows loss so well. He lost his sight, lost his family, lost his respect in society. And here he is, and he hears that Jesus is coming. And the Bible said that Bartimaeus, even though he lost a lot of things, the Bible said he took what he had, which was his voice. And the scripture said he cried out, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy. And the people around him told him to shut up. People around him told him to be quiet. Bartimaeus said, don't take all that. Bartimaeus, you're not supposed to do that. You're going to scare somebody doing that in church, Bartimaeus. They tried to shut him up. But the Bible said Bartimaeus was determined to go deeper. Bartimaeus was determined to get into the river. And the Bible said he cried out all the more, Jesus! Son of David, have mercy. And Jesus turned to him. And the Bible said he looked at those very people that tried to shut him up and said, you bring him to me. Can I tell you something? God will use the very thing that tried to stop you. God will use the very thing that tried to kill you to bring you into your purpose. He lost his sight. He lost his family. He lost his title, but he still had a shout left. And so he took what he had left and said, God, I believe that if I shout, you can give me a miracle. And there's a wind chime in this place. You may have lost a lot of things, but you still got a praise. You've still got some worship. You've still got a shout in your spirit. And God doesn't need what you've lost. All he needs is what you've got left. Stand all over this room. Come on right now. All he needs is what you've got left. Doesn't need what you've lost. He can use what you've got left. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's a wind chime in here tonight. Life has tried to steal your song. Hell has tried to silence your praise. You've lost some things in your life. But let me tell you something. Miracles don't come from the things that we've lost. Miracles don't come from the things that the enemy can take from us. Miracles come from the things that only we can give him. There's someone in here, if you still got some faith, if you still got some hope, if you still believe that God is able, if you're like that wind chime tonight, says, I'm in the middle of a storm, the worst storm of my life, but I refuse to let the storm make me go silent. I refuse to let the storm dictate my praise, because my praise is not dictated by what I'm going through. My praise is not dictated by what I feel. My praise is dictated by what I know. And I know that weeping may endure for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. I know that if I'll just hold on in the storm, if I'll hold on in the flood, if I'll hold on sooner or later, joy is coming through this song. Joy is coming through this praise. It's coming in the morning. There's someone in here tonight. I've been talking to you, wind chime. I've been speaking to your heart, and it hasn't been me. It's been God. He knew you would be here tonight. He knew you needed to hear this message. And I want to make a simple call as the team comes. That's you tonight. And you're like that wind chime. This is your decision. That whichever way the wind blows in my life, whatever I face tomorrow, whatever comes my way, whichever way the wind blows, I'll never lose my song. I'll never lose my worship. I'll never lose my praise, because I know sooner or later, God is so faithful, and he's going to show up with everything that I need. The Bible said that God showed the prophet Ezekiel a vision, and in the vision, he saw a valley of dry bones, bones that were broken, bones that were scattered, bones that were disjointed, dry bones, dead bones. And he looked out over them, and God said, prophesy to those bones. And Ezekiel began to speak to them, just like I've preached tonight. And the Bible said, as he preached the word of the Lord to those bones, that there was a sound. There was a shaking. There was a rattling. The sound came before they were put back together. And as the sound began to come, those bones came together. And the Bible said, what was broken was put back together. There's someone in here tonight that's come in broken. There's someone in here tonight that's come in scattered and disjointed. But God says to you, and this is your word tonight, that if you'll make that sound of worship in spite of your brokenness, if you'll make that sound of praise in spite of that dead situation, God said what's dead can come back to life. God said what's broken can come back together, and the process can begin tonight. So if that's you, not a moment longer, step out of your seat and join me in this altar. Come on, from all over this room, come join me in this altar. I need all my wind chimes to come meet me here. All my worshipers, come meet me here. All my praisers, come meet me here. Come on, pack it in close. They're coming from all over. Don't miss this moment. Don't miss this moment. Everything can change for you right here, wind chime. All God needs is what you got left. When you get down into this altar, I want you to close your eyes, and I want you to stretch your hands up and make this your prayer tonight on this last night of conference. That God, whatever happens for the rest of this year, whatever comes in my life, I'll never lose this posture of worship. I'll never lose my thankfulness and gratitude of praise to you. Come on, if that's you, as we begin to sing and worship all together, come on, tell them that right now. Father, I worship you. Whichever way the wind blows, I'll praise you. Whatever comes my way. Hands are lifted all over this room. I feel God in this place. I feel the glory of God. The glory of God is in this room. The glory of God is in this room. Tears are falling. Tears are falling. That's it. That's it. Press in. Press in. Go a little bit deeper. Dip one more time, Naaman. Believe one more time, Naaman. Come on, team. Let's sing together.
Because the enemy has been defeated.
Oh, yeah.
And death couldn't hold you down. We're gonna lift our voice in victory. We're gonna make your praises loud.
this room of worship. There's a shout that's about to come up in this room that's going to bring strongholds down throughout this community, throughout this church, throughout this city, and throughout this state. And so if you're in here tonight, I want you to get the best shout of the weekend, because I believe that chains are about to break. Walls are about to come down. Depression's coming down tonight. Addiction's coming down tonight. Come on, if you believe it, all together, one, two, three, give them a shout.
Thanks again for watching. Make sure you come see us on Sunday nights at 6:30 and follow us on all of our social media platforms at Connection FM.